So, I talked to you last night about the most important thing is the development of your team, the development of your people. And how do we develop people? Sometimes we have tools, and sometimes we have events, and sometimes we have trainings. Sometimes we have mentorship. But the name of the game, the name of the game, at the beginning, for sure, is the skills necessary for not only you to succeed in this profession, but for you to be good enough of an influencer to teach others. Because without the skills, guess what? People don't take action. They're too insecure. They're too afraid. And without action, the negative self-image reinforces itself over and over and over. Because without action, they're not going to get results. Without results, it makes them feel worse about themselves. They start doubting the profession itself. So it all comes back to skills. Of course, we're going to build belief over time. But guess where rock solid belief starts? Faith. It starts with seeing something that isn't real in front of them right at the moment. To believe that it's going to happen at some point in the future. It's got to start with faith. And then with faith, you can, if you believe that this is available to you, it's possible for you, then you will start to engage in these skills. And as you engage in skills at a higher and higher and higher level, that faith turns into hope. You start feeling hopeful. You start feeling, maybe this is for me. You start feeling, it could be my turn. And over time, with enough reinforcement, with enough feedback, with enough results, a step at a time, a day at a time, a brick at a time, that hope turns into belief. And once belief sinks in, you see the people on the stage, the common denominator, belief. You can't knock them out. You can't discourage them. You can't plant a seed of doubt in their minds. They've got this. They believe in the profession. They believe in their products. They believe in their company. They believe in themselves. They believe in their team. They believe. So skills build a foundation for everything. Now, some of you, there's so many people in this room that are better networkers than I ever was. So many million-dollar-a-year earners in this room. It's just like they're everywhere. It's like, oh, yeah, you're a million-dollar earner. Oh, nice to meet you. When I started in this profession, six-figure earner was the holy grail. I mean, it's still awesome, but it's everywhere. It's just like sand on the beach, another six-figure earner. How many people are earning six figures or more in network marketing? Stand up, please. Take a look around. This is normal, folks. Congratulations to all of you. If you're making more than $250,000, stay standing. Everybody else sit down. More than $250,000, take a look. How big of an executive do you have to be in a corporation to get paid this kind of money? If you're getting paid $500,000 or more, stay standing. Everybody else have a seat. $500,000 or more. $1 million a year or more, stay standing. Everybody else have a seat. $1 million a year. If these people worked in a corporation, in a Fortune 500 company, the CFO would be having a meeting about them immediately, trying to figure out a way to pay them less money. Look at these people. 1.5 million, stay standing. Everybody else have a seat. 1.5 million a year. Look at that. Unbelievable. $2 million a year. Stay standing. Everybody else have a seat. $2 million a year. It's unbelievable. Big numbers. All right, everybody, go ahead and have a seat. Guess where this started? It started with faith for all of them. Faith that maybe, just maybe, this thing that I can't totally understand might be real for me. And then they began the journey to develop the skills. With the skills, their confidence started to grow. So I'm going to ask you, even if you've been around for a while, to not be too cool for the skills. Not be too cool for what I'm going to share with you. Because either it's for you, or it's to give you a few ideas you can bring back to your team to be more of a positive influence with that team. So one way or the other, you're going to win. All right? So how many skills are the fundamental skills of the network marketing profession? There's seven fundamental skills. Let me go through the seven fundamental skills, and I want you to rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on each one of these skills, where you're at this moment, okay? Number one, finding prospects, finding people to talk to. That's a skill. You got to develop this. If you're not sure who you're going to talk to, you got to work that out. Number two, inviting. How do you get people to take a look? When I first got involved in the profession, I thought people would at least want to take a look. I was wrong. They don't even want to look, even want to understand. That's a skill. It's the gateway skill. If you don't figure this out, your career is going to be really, really short. If people don't take a look, they won't understand. If they don't understand, they don't participate. So, inviting number two. Scale of 1 to 10, where are you on these first two skills? How would you rate yourself? Are you a 10? You a 2? You a 5? Do you let your upline do it for you? Where are you? Number three is presenting. How do you present to these people in a way that helps them see the picture, but also duplicates? So other people can do it too. How do you communicate your message of your product or your opportunity to the people? Are you good at that? Do you still need to work on it? Where do you put yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 in presenting? Skill number four is following up. The fortune is in the follow-up. Most people aren't going to make a decision the first time you talk to them. It's going to take a little bit of follow-up. So in that follow-up, there's answering questions. There's overcoming objections. How do you deal with that? Are you okay with it? I went through three phases when it came to objections. I hated them at first. I just hated them. The objection showed up. I ran the other way. Seriously, I was like, some will, some won't, so what? I'm out of here. I'd run the other way because there's more people. I don't need to deal with this stuff. And I'd walk away from good prospects. And then I fought with them. People give me their objection, I'd fight with them like crazy. I'll tell you why you're wrong and why I'm right. Didn't work out so well. And then eventually I learned how to be a professional and deal with these objections and help these people get a clearer picture, a greater understanding of what I had to offer. So this is really important. Rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10. Where's this land? Oh my God. Walking by this group, every one of them million-dollar earners, is a little freaky. It's like, oh, million, 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 million. Oh, okay, million, million, million. Kind of cool. So, where do you rate yourself, scale of 1 to 10 with that? Next is closing, helping a person make a decision to become a customer or to become a distributor. Do you have too many people thinking about it? You haven't been able to help them make a decision? How do you help those people make a decision? How do you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10? The duplication skill. You want to know what the duplication skill is? Is getting a new person started effectively. Helping that person get off to a quick start, helping them get some results, helping them create some commissions, customers, something. Because the clock's ticking. Person starts a traditional business, they'll give you 3 years before they start looking for results. But in network marketing, they'll give you 3 weeks. You better get some results in those first 3 weeks, because if you don't, it's easy to get in, it's easy to get out. Price of entry is so low. Like, I'll write it off, I'll do something else. So that's skill number six. How good are you with your systems to get people started effectively? Are you good? Are you strong? Are you solid? Or does it need work? Is it the same for everybody, or is it all over the board? Where do you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on getting people started effectively? And then skill number 7, promoting events. This is the highest paying skill in all of network marketing. Your ability to get people, get butts in seats at your destination events, at your company conferences, at your regional events, at events like this, pays you so much money. It does so much of the work for you. If you're good at this, it solves a lot of the problems and it gives you time to develop the other skills. If you could become just good at promoting. So, these are the 7. Where do you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on each one of these? My goal today, I have 4 hours with you today in total to give you a short course on these 7 skills. Now, can I get you all the way from wherever you are to a 10 today? Probably not. Because guess what most of the learning is going to come from? The doing. You're going to have to get some ideas, put them into practice, modify it a little bit, put it into practice, overcome your fears, put it into practice, learn a little bit more, go through your notes, put it into practice. It takes time to become world class. It takes time to develop the skills. There's practice involved. There's activity involved. But I can give you a roadmap. I can give you direction. And I can, just with the ideas, inspire you with a little bit more faith than maybe you had at the beginning of this conversation to go take the action that maybe you wouldn't have taken without what we're about to talk about. So if you're already amazing, congratulations, that's great. What we talked about yesterday is growing the thickness of the influencers within your organization is the real key to growth. The foundation of all of that is these skills. That's the foundation of everything. Now, as we start with this and we talk about these 7 skills, I'm going to get through as many as I can get through in this session. Then tonight, at the end of the night, when you're exhausted, I'm going to give you the rest. But one of the most important things that you need to realize in our profession that's different than other people's professions is the power of your story. Your story is a bigger deal. Here, you don't talk to the corporate executive at the bank and say, well, let me tell you my story. The corporate executive doesn't talk to his friend, the attorney, and say, well, let me tell you my story. They just don't do that. It's very transactional. But a big part of how we help other people see the picture for themselves is for us to tell our story. Learning how to do that. Now, if I could give you any gift, it is that you learn how to tell your story incredibly well and effective, but not only that, that everybody on your team does it as a reflex. Not as a, oh, I should tell the story. It's automatic. My friend Emily Vavra, every time, she's amazing, and Hayden, and all this whole group is awesome. Love these guys. And they're from Minnesota, which makes me double happy about them. But if you talk to Emily, as an example, and she talks to any new person, within 60 seconds, she's going to say something to the effect of, is it all right if I tell you my story real quick? She immediately does. She goes into that, and the story builds rapport. The story lowers the defenses. The story makes people want to learn more. The story that you're telling is the glue. I've learned from one of my key mentors in the network marketing, or in business, one of my key mentors. All business, write this down, please. It might take you a while for you to totally understand what I'm about to say, but let me tell you. All business is conversation. It's all it is. It's conversation. Your job is to start more conversations and keep them going. And in the conversation, you will find opportunity. Don't need to worry about the hard close and the fast sell and all that stuff. Don't need to worry about that. Just start the conversation. keep the conversation going. And in the conversation, the magic will happen. So if people are talking, you and people in your group are talking about your business is in action. Your business is alive. If conversations have stopped, your business is dead. So your goal is to create conversation. What a better way to create conversation than through story. Story is amazing. So I'm going to teach you how to tell your story. We're going to go through a little exercise. If you're ready, say, I'm ready. Four parts to telling your story. Part number one, four elements. Element number one is your background. You are a firefighter. You are a business person. Give me some backgrounds real quick. Oil field. Massage therapist. Law enforcement. Medical auditor. Research assistant. Self-employed. Doing what? Lawn care business. Engineer. Military. Banking. Real estate. Fund manager. Corporate America what? Sales. IT. How about you? HR. How about you? Law enforcement. Everybody's got one. If you're a teacher, you're a firefighter, it doesn't matter. If you're a student, that's your story. I'm a student. You know? I wait tables. Whatever it is, everybody's got a story. So your background is part number one. Part number two of your story is what you didn't like. What were the parts of that background that weren't perfect for you? Now, I'm not telling you you have to say, I hate my background. I was a teacher and I hate it. I'm not saying you have to do that. I work for a charity and I hate it. I'm not saying you have to do that. But there is something that is not perfect in any background. If you're a blue-collar worker, maybe it's hard on your body. Maybe it's dependent on the economy up and down. Maybe it's dependent on the weather, whether you're working or not. Unions, who knows? All kinds of things outside of your control. If you're a teacher, maybe you have to deal with politics. You're underpaid for what you're doing. You know, you got to watch out in that world, and you are so passionate about it, but no matter how good you are, there's only so much they're going to pay you. Even if you're the best teacher in the world, there's only so much you're going to get paid to teach sixth grade English. I'm sorry, that's all you're going to get. Right? No matter what it is, there's something. Might be money, might be appreciation. It might be you're bored. You know, there's no challenge anymore. There's something about it that causes you to search for something more. Part three of your story is that you found a solution. You found a solution. You found something that will help you to develop the other part of your life. You found a solution to being underpaid. You found a solution to being underappreciated. You found a solution to being out of control of your own future. You found a solution to having to kiss somebody's butt every single day that you don't respect. You found a solution. And then number four is how you feel about the future. How do you feel about the future now? How do you feel when you get up in the morning, now that you have a solution, now that you've found this thing, now that you've created this new path in your life? Even though you're maybe still full-time in that background, but now you've got a way where 3 years from now, 5 years from now, you can be living a different life. Okay? So I know we have lots of different organizations here, so I'd like you to keep this without company names or without product mentions. But what I would like you to do in a moment, and I want you to play like a pro in this session, okay? Don't be an amateur or a poser and be too cool for this stuff. Because I get it. I'm about to ask you to tell your story to a stranger. And when they go and when I am at church and they say hi to the person on your right and on your left, guess who I say hi to? I say hi to my wife and I sit down. I'm asking you not to do that. Some of you are going to say, this is an excellent time to go to the bathroom because I've been needing to go to the bathroom. Right? Don't hide from this exercise. Feel it. I want you to find somebody you don't know well. And also, please don't say, let's pretend we don't know each other. Don't do that either. I want you to find somebody you don't know well that speaks the same language as you. And I want you to tell your story to them. And I want them to turn around and tell their story back to you. I'm going to give you a total of 5 minutes, 30 seconds to find your partner, 2 minutes for one side, 2 minutes for the other side, and back in your chair. You have to work with me. When I say stop, get back to your chair. Ready, set, go. Halfway done, halfway done. You should switch by now. One minute. Start wrapping it up and find your way back to your chairs when you're done. 30 seconds.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Fine light in the beautiful sea. I chose to be happy. You and I.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, give yourselves a big round of applause. Grab a seat quick as you can. Quick as you can. Now, we need to go quick on this, but I want to ask, give me some observations. What did you notice in this exercise? Anyone? She noticed that the two of them had a lot in common. How many people noticed you had a lot in common with somebody else? All right, what else? They're in love with what they're doing. The passion is infectious. What else? Everyone has a story. Everybody has problems. Huh? Everybody found a solution. They weren't just whining about it. Go ahead.
Wow. 1 second. I need to breathe. Okay. I'm 67 years old, and I've...
It's not that big a trophy. Come on.
And a quarter.
Yes.
I understand now when I tell my story that is not the right way, that there is a better way. Because now I have zero income and I decide that this is my way to help my family and to help others because I am a nurse. I was born a nurse. I want to help people and I want to help my family. And the other way bring me in 67 and a quarter with zero income.
Mm-hmm. That's most people.
So this, 2 weeks ago, I quit the job that I worked so hard. I cannot believe how I worked so hard. I took the money that they gave me and I come here.
Yep. Well, congratulations. Here we go. I thought you were gonna start recruiting us. I was just gonna say, hey, we're already in, sister. We're all signed up. What else did you learn? How many people made a really quick 2-minute friend? When you see each other in the hallway, it's gonna be different. How many people wanted to learn more? How many people instinctively in your DNA, you wanted to help the other person? Isn't that something? How would you like your prospects to want to help you? Wouldn't that be interesting? Instead of running away. Now, how many people felt like it was appropriate to bring up an objection? Anyone? Like, I want to object to your story. How many people felt a need to criticize the other person? Anyone? No criticism, no objections, all love. In 2 minutes. How many people went second? Raise your hands, please. And how many of you were more open because the other person went first? Like, oh, all right, you went first. All right, I'll tell you my real story. I was going to tell you the fake story. But now I'll tell you the real story since you told me the real story. Fine. So, one of these four elements, and some of you follow my stuff, you know the answer to this question, so I won't do the big trick with you. But if you put up the four elements of the story, your background, what you didn't like, that you found a solution, how you feel about the future, one of those four is absolutely far and away the most important. And most people, first time they see this, they don't realize which one. And the answer is what you didn't like. Your dissatisfaction is the most important. Your pain is the most important. Because listen to me, nobody cares about how cool you are and how great your future is. And a matter of fact, they might resent it. Oh yeah, you're going to brag about how cool you are. Tell me more about your company. Tell me more about how excited about your future. You're acting all big shot, giving them all the facts. They don't care. They're not even listening. They're waiting for it to be over. What's most important is that you build a connection with another human being over your shared experiences, over your pain, over your hurt, over your challenges. That's what builds rapport. That's what makes people want to help. That's what makes people want to listen. It's the most important thing. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you to do it again and find a different person this time. And this time, I want you to emphasize your dissatisfaction. I want you to be more real than maybe you've ever been to another human being, because we're taught never show your weakness, never talk about your pain. Nobody wants to hear about it, right? Be strong, man up, stiff upper lip, all that stuff. What I'm going to ask you to do is be more authentic than maybe you've ever been to another human being and say, the way that they treat me at that office has made me feel small for the last 10 years. In the last 5 years, that smallness has turned into resentment, and I don't want to live like that anymore because it's spilling into the rest of my life. I'm tired of getting paid 10% of what I'm worth. I'm tired of being unappreciated for the efforts that I put in to help somebody else do what they need to do. I'm tired of the limitations. I'm tired of saying, no, we can't afford it to my kids. I'm done with it. I don't want to feel like this anymore. So whatever that is for you, whatever that is for you, say it like you maybe never even said it to your spouse because you're trying to protect them from your pain. Maybe you've never said it to your friends because you're just trying to be strong. Your kids certainly don't know because you're trying to be tough. For this moment, in this safe environment, I want you to do that, okay? All right, 5 minutes. Find a new partner. Ready, set, go.
Throw it back to you.
If you don't have a partner, just raise your hand. Find a partner.
I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. Backbeat, the word is on the street that the fire in your heart is out. I'm sure you've heard it all before, but you never really had it down. Now, and all the roads we have to walk are winding, and all the lights that lead us there are blinding. There are many things that I would like to say to you, but I don't know how. Because maybe should have somehow realized what you not to do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. And all the roads that lead you there were winding, and all the lights that light the way are blinding.
Two minutes. One minute. Thirty seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Give yourselves a big round of applause. Come on. Grab a seat quick as you can. Quick as you can. All right, how many of you had an enjoyable experience? Raise your hands, please. How many people made another two-minute friend? When you see him in the hallway, it's gonna be special. How many of you traded information because you wanna stay in touch? How many are gonna see him later tonight? I'm just kidding. Vulnerability sexy, I'm just saying. Now, here's the thing. This isn't hard. This is friendly. This is light. This is enjoyable. Most of you did this with a perfect stranger. And within a few minutes, you built rapport with another human being. The opportunity to talk to that person. How many people felt like you wanted to learn more? Tell me more. Right? It's natural. Any entrepreneur naturally connects the dots in their mind. If you just tell a story, an entrepreneur is going to say, well, maybe this could work for me. I don't know. Maybe. Entrepreneurs connect the dots. Entrepreneurs can't walk into a venue like this without counting seats. An entrepreneur can't look at the concession stand outside and figure out how many people they got and what's going on. I mean, entrepreneurs are a unique breed. They look for opportunity, and they look to see how they can connect with the opportunity. So, doing this is critical, and it's important, and you need to do all four things. I'm going to do a two-minute exercise with you, and you don't need to leave your seat. What I want you to do is I want you to do your story one more time, 2 minutes, 1 minute on each side. That's it. But this time, you're forbidden to give your background, and you're forbidden to talk about what you didn't like about it. You can't do that. All you get to talk about is, hey, I found a solution. Here's how I feel about the future. Okay? 1 minute, and then turn around. The other person gets to do it 1 minute back to them. You can stay in your seat to do this with the person next to you. Ready, set, go. 2 minutes. One minute. Seconds. Okay, stop, that's enough. Now, how did that feel? Way different, right? How many people did it feel pushy? Did it feel salesy? Rushed? Awkward? Incomplete? Didn't know where to start? See, here's what I'm talking about. It's the same third and fourth thing that you talk about before, but without building rapport, it feels way different. Your prospects are going to be naturally guarded in the conversation if you don't just tell them your background and what you didn't like, and you build some rapport. Now, if you're going to do this with someone, and let's say you tell them your story, but they won't tell you theirs. They just don't naturally start talking like you guys just did in the exercise. Well, that's normal. My friend Tom Chenault is the absolute genius at this. He interviews everyone he meets. He interviews them. He just says, well, tell me about you. Where do you come from? What's your story? He asks them the four questions. What's your background? Were there any parts of your background that wasn't the perfect scenario? What was the good part? What was the bad part? What was the challenging part? If you could change any part, what would you change? He gets all this information, builds rapport with another human being, and then it's very easy for him, through his story and through effective follow-up, to build a connection and at least get a person to take a look with an open mind. That's the goal. So you need to develop the muscle of storytelling. Guess what most of you are really good at right now? Fact giving. Let me tell you how awesome my company is. Let me tell you how amazing my product is. Let me tell you how incredible the compensation plan is. Have I told you we're expanding into a new country? Have I told you we have this new tool? Let me blah, 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 blah. Nobody cares. Take a second, build rapport, build a connection with a real human being, and then they'll learn everything you got. Don't worry about it. So, here's the challenge for you. First challenge is from now to January 1st, every person in this room, I want you to tell your story to 100 people. It's not that big a deal. If it's a reflex, I promise you it's not a big deal for Tom Chenault. I promise you it is not a big deal for Emily Vavra. Because it's what they do as part of breathing. It's not part of your breathing. That's why you don't have the success that you want to have in your business. So tell your story 100 times. Tell it to your spouse, because your spouse probably doesn't know your real story. Tell it to your kids. Tell it to your best friends. Tell it to your brothers and sisters. Hey, maybe I pushed this on you. Maybe I was aggressive with you. But let me tell you why I'm doing this for real. Tell your story to 100 people. That's 3 a day for 30 days. And over that period of time, you'll find it being friendly, fun. You remember the social media challenge I gave you yesterday in the panel? I want you to start a conversation with every single person you're connected with on social media. A private conversation. Just start it. And at some point, when it's appropriate, tell your story to that person. And at some point, ask them some questions about their story. And let it evolve until there's an appropriate time. He's always busting me. Let it evolve until there's an appropriate time for you to have a proper business conversation. Right? Don't need to do it in the first 15 seconds, but do it. Okay? So how many people will accept the 100 story challenge? Raise your hands, please. Tell it to the person cleaning your room in the hotel. Tell your story to the person serving you food at lunch. Tell it. Tell it to your upline. Send a message to your company owner. Tell them your story. They want to know. Tell it to your team. At the beginning of every presentation, tell your story. At the end of every presentation, tell it one more time. At your training sessions, tell a story. Stories sell. Stories make the difference.